Welcome to Unraveling the Pattern. I'm Lauren, and this is an in-depth breakdown of all of the details I noticed in the first official trailer for The Wheel of Time on Amazon Prime. I call it Unraveling the Teaser. If you're new to my channel, please subscribe and like the video. I make a ton of deep dive videos for new fans and old fans of The Wheel of Time. I have a bunch of spoiler-free content for new fans, including a series of videos I'm very proud of called Watt 101, where I discuss topics related to The Wheel of Time without any plot, character, or story spoilers. Watch the Watt 101 playlist. I also have an ongoing series of spoiler-free timeline history deep dives called Wheel of Timelines, and some other cool deep dives about the world and metaphysics of the Wheel of Time. And of course, I have spoiler-heavy content as well. I have a spoiler-heavy video about the Heron-Mark Blade, and check out this fun battle breakdown video I did as a collaboration with Nablus, another popular Wheel of Time YouTuber. Please stick around and check out my other content. There will be way more to come as the show comes out. Let's get to 10,000 subscribers before the show. Okay, enough about me. Spoiler warning, this video is for fans who have read the prequel novel Newspring and all of the Wheel of Time books. If you're new to the TV show or haven't read the whole Wheel of Time book series and the prequel, this video is not for you. Keep an eye out for my spoiler-free teaser breakdown video coming soon. Seriously, you don't want this amazing story spoiled. You've been warned. My initial reactions were very positive. I like the colors, the music, the dialogue, the presentation, and all of the shots are gorgeous in my opinion. It felt so incredible to finally see this story that I've loved for almost 30 years come to life. I know there's been some controversy surrounding the look of the One Power and the colorful costumes, but I like all of it and I can't wait to see more. I like that they're establishing a look that isn't drab and gritty like Game of Thrones. It feels more like the Lord of the Rings movies to me. I think, just like how the Harry Potter movies changed the look and feel over time, we'll likely see things change over time as well, as the show progresses through the seasons. The only thing that didn't stand out to me was the music, which felt like pretty standard trailer music. I didn't hate it, it just didn't stand out. Now, let's unravel this bad boy. The teaser trailer contains 89 shots. 86 if you remove the cut to black shots. About 70 of the shots appear to show scenes that are either not in the books or are different from the books in some way. From what I can tell, there are between 25 to 30 different scenes being shown, and we hear 6 different people talking throughout the trailer, probably from 7 or 8 different scenes. I think it will be easier to break this down by scene, rather than by each individual shot. However, before I reorder this, I want to discuss the sequence as it was presented in the original teaser trailer, along with the dialogue. I love the juxtaposition of the dialogue and the visuals. In the beginning, Nynaeve says, "Be strong," before she pushes Egwene off the cliff in what seems to be some sort of coming-of-age Two Rivers ceremony or wisdom training. This feels similar to "be steadfast," which is said during the accepted test. Look at how Nynaeve is Mother Bear throughout these shots in the teaser. Even as she pushes Egwene, she seems to be doing it with love. Then look at how Lan swoops in to protect Nynaeve later, here. Does this make Lan Papa Bear? Back to the dialogue. Moraine says the classic line, "The Wheel of Time turns and ages come and pass, leaving memories that become legend." We see some beautiful shots of Emmons Field, or Two Rivers, as it is described in the official Amazon summary. We also get to see Matt placing a dice cup on the table and grabbing dice as he plays with Perrin and Rand, and they actually seem like friends. Look at how they respond to Matt's joke. Then Egwene walks in and Rand beams up at her like a lovesick puppy. So does Nynaeve. There's more chemistry between Rand and Egwene in the few shots we've received than in all of the books. However, I noticed a pattern. Rand is always beaming at Egwene, but she seems to have other things on her mind. When Moraine says, "leaving memories," we see this sad image of Stepan, played by Peter Franzen, the warder to Kareen Nagashi, played by Claire Perkins. He's crying over what is likely the death of his Aes Sedai as he clutches her Great Serpent Ring. Though not exactly as they're described in the books, I like the design of the Great Serpent Rings, along with the colored gem in the center. This makes them stand out more. I have a theory that when the Accepted are given their ring, it's just the Great Serpent part without the gem piece, sort of like an engagement ring as part of a wedding band. Or the ring they're given has no color or no gem until after they're made full Aes Sedai and accepted into their Aja. My favorite line of dialogue goes along with one of the most beautiful shots in the trailer. Moraine says, "that become legend," just as we see Egwene coming out of the water, covered in the colors of the 7 Ajas. I love the foreshadowing in this scene and the nod to Egwene as a legend. Is this scene the ending of the river initiation sequence with Egwene? Or could it be one of Min's visions, or maybe a dream? Could this be part of the accepted test? For that matter, this whole river sequence could just be a vision or an accepted test. Notice the person in this shot in the background might be wearing red. Could this be Elida? The cave-like area and the paint don't feel like they're in the same area as the river sequence. But maybe this is where she ends up at the end of the ceremony in the two rivers. What do you think? There are other really great bits of dialogue, like when Moraine is talking about the One Power. I assume she's talking to either Egwene or Nynaeve. Probably this happens during Egwene's first lesson. Moraine says, "The power inside you, all over the world there are different names for it, but it's one thing, one power, and women who can touch it, we protect the world." I find it very interesting that Moraine says the One Power goes by different names across the world. This is different from the books. I absolutely love that as Moraine talks about the One Power, we see Egwene, alone, swimming in the river, surrendering to the current. A great visual metaphor for embracing Sidar. And then that shot is immediately followed by this incredible shot of the most powerful women in the world who wield the One Power, in the Hall of the Tower, with the Armorland seat and the Keeper of the Chronicles calling order. Knowing where Egwene starts and where she will end truly is legendary. I love the contrast between these shots, humility and surrendering, and all of the pomp and circumstance of the White Tower. The shots of Tar Valon and the White Tower, as well as the streets with the sun rising and Dragonmount in the background, are all just incredible. I've seen some people complain about the architecture not looking how they imagined, but to me, this city and tower absolutely look Ogier built. I can't wait to see the shining walls as the sun beats down on the city. Someone suggested that this shot could be the result of this concept art, but I'm still sure this concept art is Shadar Logoth and that this is a shot of the streets of Tar Valon. Did you notice that the symbol on the back of the Armorland seat has 7 spokes? I also love the intensity in Jennifer Chian Garcia's face in this scene. She plays Liane, or Liana, the Keeper of the Chronicles. I can't wait to see and hear her saying, she comes, the Watcher of the Seals, the Flame of Tar Valon, the Armorland Seat. You can see people talking in the background, so I assume this happens just before Swan enters. This image of Sophie Okonedo as Swan Sanche in the gaudy yet subtle Armorland stole with the 7 colors of the Ajahs sitting in the Armorland seat is incredible. But this is not how I imagine Swan. She's a fisherman's daughter who doesn't like glitz and glamour. She even appears to have tattoos that make me think she comes from Tyr. Is that a fish symbol? That's why I love this scene of her later, in a much simpler dress. This is the real Swan, and I'm so glad we get to see her as herself and as the powerful Armorland. By the way, what's the deal with this water damage look on the Armorland seat? To those who find it weird that the Aes Sedai are always dressed in their Ajah colors, I think we'll see scenes where they wear different colors, but every shot in the teaser of Aes Sedai is showing them in their formal Ajah colors. When they're in the Hall of the Tower, they're definitely wearing their formal clothing, although the browns look like they just got out of bed. I love this detail. And even when we see glimpses of the Aes Sedai out and about in the world, they're parading Loghain about and making a big show of it as they move from village to village, so it makes sense to me that they would be wearing their formal Ajah colors during these scenes as well. Also, this is a new world to millions of potential new fans, so it makes sense to me that they would want the production design, things like costume and set design, to stand out and to help tell stories without needing to over-explain everything. There are a bunch of other great clips, which I'll discuss later, but getting back to the dialogue, I also love the visuals that go along with Tam's lines. First he says, "No matter what happens," and we see a shot of Matt and the dagger, and Mashadar and Shadar Logoth. Mashadar is more black and less fog-like than it was described in the books, but I like it. I also love the look of Shadar Logoth and this shot of Egwene and Perrin on top of the outer wall. Where are their horses? Where's Bella? Even this dreary scene is colorful, which I appreciate. Then Tam says, "All the pain we face," and we see a quick succession of shots, first of Matt churning away from a dead Aielman in a cage. Did you see the red hair and the Cadden sore? I'm not sure what the breastplate is about. I love the foreshadowing of the Aielman in a cage. Don't worry, I'm pretty sure this is just standard practice in backwater villages when a savage ginger is captured. I'm sure that's not Gaul. I now want a cameo in the show as a dead Aielman. This is followed by a quick shot of a yellow-eyed wolf and Perrin. Could that be Hopper? Tam then says, "The heartbreak," and we see Rand and Egwene together, but Egwene is looking longingly away from Rand, which reminds me again of this image. And I especially like Tam's last line and the following shots. He says, "The wheel keeps turning," with tears in his eyes. And then we see 3 circular, aerial, wheel-like shots of dancing, probably during Beltane, though it could be the Tinkers. Then an Aes Sedai funeral. Did you notice the flames in the hands of each of the Aes Sedai? Or Nynaeve tugging her braid here? And then an aerial shot that feels more like a dream or vision than a real shot of the Hall of the Tower. I can't tell if this is an animated sequence, a poorly done CGI shot, or Teleron Riad, or something else. But something about this feels stylized or off to me, or different from everything else. Did you see the colors of the Ajahs in the tiles on the floor here? Continuing with the dialogue, there's a scene of a fade on a horse with a skull mask, followed by Lan saying, "The Dark One is coming for your friends." I'm pretty sure he's talking to Nynaeve in this scene. Could this be a switch or a beating stick? This scene with the Myrdral and Trollocs is absolutely amazing, but it's hard to see all of the details. Adding just a bit of brightness and contrast, I can see a bunch of different Trolloc faces, including one or two beaks, a hog or a pig face, and a bunch of really freaky horns. I also love that some of them are shying away from the torch or firelight. At first I thought this was weird sharp horse teeth, but I think it's some sort of design on the straps on the horse's neck. Skipping more shots for now and focusing just on the dialogue, we have Swan saying, "The last battle is coming." I'm pretty sure she's talking to Nynaeve in this scene. Notice the earrings. As I mentioned, I like the simplicity of Swan's dress and the fervor in her voice. We see a quick glimpse of a Trolloc horde gathering. I'm guessing this is either a scene from Winter Night, or possibly a vision of the last battle that is coming, or maybe even Tarwyn's Gap. I think Swan also says the next line, "The only thing that matters is what you do." This is followed by a quick montage of characters doing heroic things. I love the ferocity in Egwene and Nynaeve's faces in this scene, and Nynaeve's protective stance. Is that blood on Nynaeve's hands? Maybe Nynaeve and Egwene were helping villagers who were injured. Somebody pointed out that there appears to be a blackish tendril of power behind Loghain in this shot. Could this be a visual representation of the taint? I'll discuss this shot in more detail in a bit. The final line of dialogue comes from Moraine again, as we see some of the group riding horses towards a waygate to meet up with the others. Moraine says, "Whatever happens now, there's no turning back." This feels reminiscent of a scene from the third book, when Moraine tells Faile there's no turning back. Some have speculated that Loial could be the figure here that might not be on a horse, or this could be him here.
"Look at the size of that boy's head.
I've also seen speculation that Min could be in this scene. I hope they're both in this scene. Okay, there are a ton more shots that I haven't shown yet, but I want to quickly go through my speculation of how I think these shots will be ordered in the show. My guess is that 90% of these shots come from the first 1 to 3 episodes, but I do think some of these shots come from later in the season. Also, this is just speculation, so I could be very wrong. Here we go. Here's how I think these shots should be reordered in sequence, and more details that I noticed. Right off the bat, I'm unsure about these first two shots. I like to think that we'll get the scene of Rand and Tam and Bella on an empty road, and perhaps this is what Rand sees on the quarry road. However, it feels a bit too dark. Still, they could be getting an early start, and this look of the eyeless definitely is scary. There's a saying in the Borderlands, the look of the noseless is fear. Seriously though, I like the look of this Myrdral and the horse with the skull mask. So long as the Myrdral aren't just scary screaming monsters, and they're actually intelligent and can talk, I'll be happy. I can't wait to see a Myrdral in a fight with Lan. So, these shots might happen later, but moving on. The next sequence is probably this one, with Egwene and Nynaeve doing this initiation ceremony in the Winespring water. We've already discussed these shots, and I'm unclear if this is a shot that happens at the end of the sequence or somewhere else. I think this really could be a vision or a dream too, so it might be out of sequence as well. Moving on, we have this beautiful wide shot of the two rivers. Notice how the land around the river is different from this shot that comes later. I love this shot of the village green and the Winespring Inn in the center of Emmons Field. It's possible they'll remove the name Emmons Field and just call this Two Rivers, as is seen in this official Amazon summary. Could this be Senbui here? And is this Daes Conger? I did notice that the village seems much closer to the Mountains of Mist than it is in the books. It's a long walk on the quarry road to the mountains from the village in the books. I'm guessing these scenes also happen during the day, and I think we'll see Beltane celebrations on the day before Winter Night instead of after Winter Night. I'm not sure if these scenes of Rand and his bow come before or after the end sequence during the day, but I bet we'll see some of the Beltane festivities, including the longbow competition. This feels to me like a moment when Rand is being instructed by Tam about the flame and the void. I love his wool sweater, just what a sheepherder would wear. Someone on Twitter suggested that this could be Tam and Bella in the background, and maybe this is a scene that comes earlier, after Rand sees the fade on the quarry road. Or maybe he's aiming at a raven. I would love to see a father-son moment with Tam and Rand right near the beginning. Now is also a good time to mention that I like how Rand is not the focus of this teaser, or the promotional images at all. I really think they'll keep the mystery of who the Dark One is after and why a secret for much of the first season. For those complaining that Moraine is going to be the main character, I really think this is just a bit of smoke and mirrors in the promotional content. Then we have a nighttime shot of dancing. I believe this is in Emmons Field, but it could also be a Tinker dance. It's most likely a Beltane dance though. Note the tables here, and in the shots later in the village green. As the celebrations continue, we cut back to the inn and see Moraine enter. I'm guessing this will be the first time we see Moraine in the show as she enters the inn. I think the scene of Lan and probably Nynaeve comes later. I love the idea that Lan feels like something is off or wrong, and he's out scouting around. I also love the idea that Nynaeve somehow manages to find him in the dark as he's out and about around the village. Perhaps he has sensed the Trollocs and the Murdral coming, and is running back to the village to warn Moraine. If this happens while others are celebrating, I find it interesting that Nynaeve is out. Maybe she's feeling like something bad is coming as well. Then she tracks and finds Lan, and he has to explain to her why he's out there. Once again, Nynaeve is the mother bear protecting her village, even while everyone else is having a good time. I put this shot here, of the Trollocs and Murdral, because I didn't know where else to fit it, but I don't think this is something that Lan or Nynaeve sees just yet in this same moment. I think Lan makes it back to the village just as the attack begins, and he sees the Trollocs already there, attacking. Check out this amazing shot of a Trolloc eating a villager in the background as Lan turns around. Maybe this shot or the previous shot is what Lan sees in this moment. We see Trollocs charging, just look at these boots and horns, and we even get a very quick glance at a scythe-like Trolloc sword. I imagine this scene comes at some point during the fight. Again, look at Nynaeve's protective stance. She's obviously not good at fighting with a knife. The way she slashes at whatever it is shows extreme fear and bravery. Is this blood on her hands? Could this be because she and Egwene have been tending to wounded villagers? This sequence of Moraine gathering the One Power and Lan fighting the Trollocs is so amazing. It obviously contains more VFX and CGI than the previous teasers we've seen of some of these shots. I think it makes sense to show the One Power weaves as just bright white wisps, but I do think as the audience and characters learn more about the One Power, we probably will see more colored flows and intricate weaves as the show progresses. Also, I was confused at first why it looks like Moraine is gathering or pulling the One Power from all around her, but I've realized that this makes sense, because the One Power comes from everywhere, and it has to be gathered by the Aes Sedai before it can be woven and controlled. The power doesn't come from within. I really like this detail. You can see this happening here in this shot of Alana gathering the power and weaving it here. Let's break this Winter Night battle down shot by shot. I'm not entirely sure I have these in order. It feels to me like there are probably two or three different waves of Trollocs that Lan and Moraine deal with in this sequence. I think the Trollocs are already here, maybe already attacking villagers when Lan and Moraine arrive. Also, it looks to me like the tree on the village green is not on fire in some of these scenes, so I might have the order wrong here. It's interesting that in this scene the tree is on fire. But in the lightning scene, I can't be certain, but it seems to me like these lights are lamps in the background, and the tree is not yet on fire. I could be wrong about this, but what if during the attack, it's Moraine's lightning strike that catches the tree on fire, and not the Trolloc's torches? This could give the village more of a reason to want to cast Moraine and Lan out after the battle, even though they obviously will save the village. Also, is that a tire swing hanging from the tree on the village green? Maybe that's Matt's badger in a sack. I love how Lan and Moraine work together with the One Power to attack, and I love how the Trollocs are difficult to see because of the One Power weaves that are distorting around them. You can see blood coming from the Trollocs after Lan's slash, but also they seem to be pushed back by the One Power around them. This contrast in this image is awesome. Look at Moraine's face as she weaves the One Power around her. Notice that nothing is on fire behind her. These are just Beltane lamps. The Trolloc looks like it's catching fire here. And did you catch a glimpse of this amazing serrated edge Trolloc sword in this shot? Then Moraine gathers more weaves together. The tree is visibly on fire here, so my theory about Moraine causing the fire might be wrong, or this is out of order. We get an updated view of the previous teaser image with Moraine gathering flows. The Trolloc in the background is difficult to see, but I'm pretty sure it's different from the older clip that was accidentally released by Amazon Prime a few months ago. And this awesome moment where the weaves gather the lightning and the lightning strikes. I love how this looks though, and how they incorporated the lightning strike into the title sequence later. Going back to my speculated sequence of events, I think the next shot in the sequence is Tam, probably saying goodbye to Rand. I put these next two shots here, but I'm not really sure this is where they go in the sequence. This area looks different from the area directly around the river shown as part of the two rivers earlier, and there are only five riders visible here, so I probably have this shot out of order as well. Also, this looks like the same place where this promotional image from TV Guide was shot. That's why I put this shot next in the sequence. But this really could be happening at any time. Then we have our Shadar Logoth sequence. I've already discussed these shots, but I think this is the order. First we have Perrin and Matt looking bored. Rand is probably somewhere nearby talking to Egwene or tending to the horses. Then we see Matt alone with a dagger, and as night falls, Mashadar overtakes the city and everyone gets separated. Notice we see Rand here, but not later here. I'm guessing this next sequence is slightly out of order, but these are probably scenes that happen as everyone is separated. First, we have Rand and Matt walking away from a large city in the distance. While Matt is walking away, Rand is turning back to look at the view. I can just hear Rand's thoughts as he worries about Egwene. This is not Tar Valon, as there are no bridges, no surrounding mountains or harbors, and no dragon mount. This is very likely Shadarlogoth. The outer walls seem to match this shot. I'm guessing these next scenes are happening around the same time as the sequence with Moraine being healed at Loghain's camp. I think this scene of Matt seeing the Aielman in a cage probably happens in a village while he and Rand are separated from the rest of the group. I think this shot of them running from someone is probably the same village, but at night. Somebody said they think this is a white cloak chasing them. The way they're running and almost laughing makes me think this could be the case. Did Rand just have a reaction to channeling? Also, notice that they don't have their coats and weapons here, which implies that they're staying at an inn somewhere nearby. And the other villagers standing around make me think this is not a scene in Emmons Field from Winter Night. Maybe this is the village where they meet Tom? Also, this could be that dirty beggar that's chasing them in the streets. Could this be Padan Fain? I think this is a Myrdral entering the same village later that night as it's raining. This could definitely be Four Kings. This gives me Lord of the Rings vibes. Perhaps they meet Tom and he attacks the Myrdral all in the same village? I hope we get to see Tom in more than just one episode, so maybe this happens later in a different village after Tom has joined them. These two shots of the wolf and Perrin might not actually be in sequence, but I think they are. This is all likely happening while Rand and Matt are separated, and while Moraine, Lan, and Nynaeve deal with the Loghain camp. I think Moraine was badly injured in Shadarlogoth. Notice how Lan is carrying her in this promotional image. Luckily, Lan, Moraine, and Nynaeve find Loghain's camp, and Moraine is able to be healed by Kareen Nagashi. I think as Lan is out scouting, he comes across a dead body or someone who is injured here, and then he alerts the camp of the coming attack. I think these are probably Dragonsworn or Loghain supporters. Their costumes feel like they all come from random villages. My guess is that they're attempting to free Loghain. I also think Leandrin is probably in on it. So, with Moraine either recovering from being healed, or possibly in the cave with Loghain as he's being shielded by Kareen and Leandrin, the first attack of arrows comes, and Alanna protects them. Lan protects Nynaeve. Then the Dragonsworn flood into the camp, and a battle ensues. Notice this is a woman? I like that they're not all men. I think this sequence probably happens after the initial arrow barrage. Then we cut to Loghain, probably taking advantage of the commotion happening outside of the camp, and possibly receiving help from Leandrin. You can clearly see that he's using the One Power to break the cage and the shield around him here. I love the look of the taint in his eyes and on his face. He knocks Leandrin and Kareen off their chairs as he breaks the shield. Then Kareen slams into this column, probably dying instantly. This causes Lan and Steppen to rush in and stop him. Moraine appears to be holding the shield around Loghain all by herself here. Notice the tainted look around Loghain's head. You can see Kareen Nagashi, dead or unconscious on the ground here, when Steppen rushes in to attack. He's probably going into a berserker warder mode after the death of his Aes Sedai. My guess is that Loghain will actually escape in this moment, and we'll have him getting captured and gentled later in the end of the season, or maybe even in seasons 2 or 3. The next sequence is probably the Aes Sedai funeral and Steppen crying. Then I think the remaining Aes Sedai who survived the attack are summoned to the White Tower and berated in front of the Hall of the Tower by Swan. This explains Lyanna's angry expression. They failed, and the false dragon escaped. Notice how everyone's backs are turned in this shot. I love the subtle showing of Aes Sedai politics here, and Moraine feeling like an outsider. I think this scene with Swan and Nynaeve happens after the Hall of the Tower scene, and I wouldn't be surprised if Moraine is here as well. This promotional image that was released before the trailer came out is probably a shot from this same scene. And then, we get a glimpse of the group meeting at the Waygate, which I assume leads to Faldara. Yes, this is a Waygate, as was confirmed by Amazon. And then this sequence with Rand and Egwene. I assume this is in Faldara Keep because of the stonework, but it's possible this scene happens way earlier in the season, perhaps on the day before the Winter Night attack. Whew. And that's it. I'm tired. I can't believe they're going to release the first three episodes all at once on November 19th. I'm really hoping to make individual episodic breakdown videos, but I don't think I'll be able to sleep for weeks if they don't give us content creators some form of early access to the episodes. It took me 3 days just to break down this 2-minute teaser. I'll need a month per episode at this rate. What else did you notice that I missed? Feel free to discuss all the spoilers in the comments on this video, and look out for my spoiler-free teaser breakdown video and more WOT 101 videos coming soon. Huge thanks to my patrons for keeping the lights on. Please consider supporting me on Patreon or joining me here on YouTube so I can do these deep dives more regularly. And please like and subscribe. See you on the next one.